Hey guys and girls, welcome back to the Bitcoin series, where we learn all about digital currencies and how to turn this into a passive income. My name is Jake Owens, and this is Millionaire Mindset Hub. In this episode, we take a look at the history of digital currencies to see where they came from and why they were invented. All right, let's get into it. David Chaum, an American computer scientist and cryptographer born in 1955, first introduced the idea of digital cash in 1983 within a research paper, which was the first time the concept of a cryptographic primitive of blind signature was introduced, which would allow anyone to obtain a digital currency from a bank and spend it while being completely untraceable by that bank or any other third party, other than yourself or the person you were wanting to exchange the money with. Just an FYI, if you're interested to read that original research paper, I've linked it in the description box below. You should check it out. It's really interesting. Now, I assume this idea was one of those ideas that just kept brewing in David's mind, because 7 years later, after he published that paper in 1983, in 1990, David founded DigiCash in Amsterdam, which was the world's first electronic cash company. Unfortunately, that company filed for bankruptcy in 1998 and was then acquired by Infospace on February 19th, 2002. Basically, what happened, according to David, who talked about this in an interview, he said that the reason it didn't work out was because e-commerce hadn't been fully integrated within the internet, which, as it turned out, was a significant issue. In 1996, the first successful digital currency system emerged, e-gold. This currency was very similar to the traditional currency tradition of the gold standard, as you would purchase e-gold and it would be backed by tangible gold metal to ensure its real value, which at its peak, the company Gold and Silver Reserve Inc. held 71 million United States dollars worth of gold backing its e-gold currency in 2006. What this did is instead of asking people to blindly place their trust in an unknown currency that may or may not implode at a time when the internet was still being thought of as a fad, you could back it up by something everyone knew held high value to guarantee the currency's worth, which is exactly what the United States did until they officially moved away from the gold standard in 1973. Even though e-gold launched in 1998, it didn't become popular until 2000, around the time the dot-com bubble was at its peak. However, unlike a lot of companies that went bust over that time period, e-gold continued to expand and reached over 1 million accounts by 2004. However, due to e-gold's ease of overseas transfers and other problems with their system and account creation processes, such as their customer verification methods, which were virtually non-existent, e-gold was shut down by the United States government due to their vast amount of illegal activity on the platform, which was eventually overturned by a federal judge. However, as they were still not able to initiate a system of reliable user identification, this ended up being the death of the business. It's important to mention that in 1998, PayPal was created. Of course, this isn't a digital currency. However, the rise and overwhelming success of PayPal just shows the general population was getting more and more accustomed to online payment processes where no hard cash was involved, which is of great significance when we look at the development of digital currencies, which is solely dependent on trust and perception of value rather than a tangible resource that can be seen being given in exchange for goods and services. In 2006, another digital currency emerged out of Costa Rica. It was called the Liberty Reserve, which allowed users to exchange dollars or euros to Liberty Reserve dollars or euros for a 1% fee. However, like e-gold, it had a very low standard of validating its users, which consisted of a name, email address, and date of birth, which made it very attractive for the underground market. And, just like e-gold, the United States government shut down the platform by using the Patriot Act and prosecuting the founder, Arthur Budovsky, and six others with money laundering and operating with an unlicensed financial transaction company. China is a country of very quick adaptation. They're always onto the next thing every single week and are radically technologically different in the day-to-day practices than people in the West. Or at least that's what my Chinese Uber driver said last week. In 2005, a currency called Qcoins or QQ coins were used as a commodity-based digital currency on the Tencent QQ's messaging platform, which also offers online games, music, shopping, movies, and more. This digital currency was so popular in China that the government had to regulate the coin because it was having a destabilizing effect on the Chinese traditional currency, the renminbi, or more commonly known as the yuan. This just shows the power of these digital currencies and how they can drastically change the way we live day to day and destabilize the traditional ways we think about money and how it functions in society. The thing to mention about e-gold and Liberty Reserve is that they were centralized currencies which gave the government the ability to halt the continuance of the service by shutting down the central ledger system, which was the singular way the platform was able to operate, just like how traditional currencies operate. But in 2008, something revolutionary appeared. Bitcoin. Which is what we're going to be covering next week in the second part to this two-part series, the history of digital currency. So make sure you subscribe so that you know when the next video is released. Hey guys and girls, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed. If the video provided you with any value, please hit that subscribe button below and like the video. If you've got any questions or comments, or would just like to reach out and say hi, feel free to do so in the comment section, or feel free to PM me. Again, thanks a ton for watching. I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Cheers.